Imagine 4:30 a.m. in the morning, and 500,000 people are watching the live stream of your own TV channel from the first attempt of the riot police to crack down the popular uprising. It's the third week of the Euromaidan Revolution, 11th of December, and this is an uprising against the police brutality and the corruption. And there is nothing more exciting than to go on and watch, because at that particular moment you think that is the most exciting, the most decisive moment of the revolution in just 3 weeks. 4:30 a.m. at night, and I put my alarm at 5:30 a.m. and turn off the computer to fall asleep and to wake up in an hour. Because the last night I've been, it was my shift to work in the street, and I'm absolutely exhausted. But what I know that by 6 a.m., all my team would be exhausted. They won't be any longer able to work. The equipment would be frozen because it's minus 15 on the street. So somebody should come back there early in the morning when maybe there would be less audience. That's definitely not the most dramatic moment of our revolution, but that's exactly the moment when they very much remember what does it mean to make public service and serve. And some months ago before that, there was a group of us, a dozen of journalists, not friends, people with different ideas and ideals, gathered together around the idea to create public broadcasting in Ukraine. And we created that NGO named Hromadske, public in Ukrainian. That was the environment where all the TV channels were owned by the oligarch, by the way, as now, and broadcasting the government propaganda, but attracting their audience with the idol shows, crime news, tabloid-style stories. So we guessed it, and it worked. And people loved it, especially during the revolution. We were followed, we were appreciated. I think all my colleagues felt like the rock stars, though it was pretty tragic. And we know the revolution ended up with the murder of 70 activists on the street by the government. Our dictator was gone. And that was, of course, tragic, but the revolution had won. And we were, though exhausted, but wanted to have a bit of the break and keep our politicians' new elite accountable. However, at that moment, the second front had been opened and Russia annexed Crimea, also with a use of force. As well, later, the war in the Donbas started. And I was there, and as a foreign news reporter previously reporting from conflicts like Iraq and being in Egypt covering others' revolution, that was so painful that I can't really go to another side, because different than covering other conflicts, I wasn't accepted, because we, the Ukrainian journalists, were the targets at that time. Also, at that moment, there was the birth of the phenomenon which all know us today, the fake news. And that was to the scale we couldn't imagine earlier. Now, when we, like activists like myself and journalists, were named to be Nazis by Russian media, or for instance, I imagine the situation when I was in Crimea and there were two neighbors staying, and one would say, look, we don't need this Ukraine because we have an underground lake in our village, so we don't need the water coming from the Ukrainian mainland. And there would be another neighbor saying, like, but we don't have an underground lake. And that was the case. That was not a matter of opinion. And in this strange situation, of course, the public, we all were puzzled. What have we do? There is such a huge propaganda machine against the whole country. So you, good guys from Hromadske, you have to support our government. You have to report. You have to debunk all this fake news. And we said, like, wait. There is a different role we have. Our role is to serve the public, and our role is to report, not really just to support the government. And yes, if you just debunk the fake news, you're following the same narrative, but somebody should go to the street and report. And sometimes, even if it's a just war, if it's a defense war, you go and see the houses, because the houses are destroyed, not by the fake news, but the real mortars. And sometimes it happens, they are destroyed by your army, by the Ukrainian army. And people don't like to hear that, and you would be criticized for that. Moreover, there are investigations, we're doing them, because even though it is new elite, it's revolutionary coming to the power, some people out of them are rotten, some of them are still corrupt. And you do that, and you would have all the commands on everywhere that how dare you investigate your government and criticize in the time of war. And there would be former revolutionary leaders, activists, and for instance, military commanders who would use the opportunity to comment on everything, tell exactly what people want, from the economy to foreign policy, and sometimes saying nonsense, and you would challenge them. And the audience would say, but How can you do that? Why are you challenging our heroes? And at the same time, there are no magician at the moment who would do your spreadsheet, would do your reporting, and you still have to create your boards, you still have to hire people, take care that equipment is working, and all the time ask for money, be the fundraiser, because it's your organization, you have to do that, and often answer the question of your potential donors that like, why, guys, why you are not that liked as you were during the Maidan Revolution? Sometimes people are criticizing you, so what's going on wrong with you? And maybe this talk is not about the most dramatic moments of the revolution. And I should also say that maybe after it, you don't know everything about what was the Maidan Revolution about, how the Crimean annexation had happened, and how, for instance, and what happened later, and the whole phenomenon of the fake news. But I hope with this talk you would understand and probably get this feeling. What does it mean to build something after the revolution is over, when the people are not any longer mobilized, when not everybody is supporting you, when half of your team is gone because they are disillusioned, and some other have some personal issues, and this the third, the fourth, the fifth years of all that things, because that's all about the choices we make. Sometimes you definitely, and that's what I believe, to do this invisible job, which probably isn't appreciated, and often you even disliked and even harassed for it, but that's what I believe we do if we would like to win in a long run. Thank you.